If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
Mind Pump.
So for the first 45 minutes, we do our introductory current events conversation. We start off by talking about the ineffectiveness of yelling.
That's right.
This is while I'm yelling.
You're crazy, man!
We talk about My Museum, San Francisco trip. We talk about Mind Pump's Tampa trip. We had a good time over there talking to a couple friends of ours, Ben Pekulski being one of them.
Yeah.
I mentioned Green Chef. Green Chef delivers meals that you cook at home. What a great way to...
Excited about this sponsor, man.
Oh, yeah. Mostly organic food, very high quality. We are sponsored by them.
I might even help you, honey.
If you want to try them out, it's what you do. Go to greenchef.us/mindpump, and you're going to get $50 off your first box. Then we talk about reducing the risk of getting sick by using cold contrast. A new study came out showing 29% reduction in sick days. Mm. We also mentioned the new sauna that we have here at Mind Pump headquarters from Sunlighten. Now, we like it so much that we got a deal for you. If you go to sunlighten.com and order yourself an infrared sauna and you tell them you heard it through Mind Pump, you'll get free shipping. That shipping can get expensive, too, with those big old things.
Oh, yeah, it'll cost like $500 to $1,000 just to get that sucker shipped.
So you'll save all that. Wow. We also talk about the dangers of using vape cigarettes. Might still be better for you than regular cigarettes.
Here's a danger. You look like an idiot.
We talk about paying college athletes. Should they be paid or should they still be paid under the table? Mm. And then we mentioned Organifi's gold drink. They are also one of our sponsors. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MindPump, you will get a discount. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, this individual has Hashimoto's, which is an autoimmune issue that attacks the thyroid. What is our opinion on the autoimmune protocol diet or other diets for autoimmune issues? Now, we did mention Thrive Market there because you can go to Thrive Market and actually pull down drop-down menus and do something like paleo, which in this case may benefit them. They are also one of our sponsors. If you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, you'll get 1 month free, $20 off your first three orders of more, of $49 or more, excuse me, and free shipping. And then the next question we get into was, what is the best MAPS program for fat loss, or what is the best programming for fat loss in general? We talk about our HIIT program. It is probably the best calorie burning program we have.
Yes.
However, it's not for everybody. Find out if it's for you in this episode. And finally, the last question, how important is the mind-muscle connection? Thinking about the muscle, squeezing the muscle, feeling the muscle. Does it matter or should you just do the exercises? What do we know about this?
Can you
also feel it? This month we did launch our new program, MAPS HIIT. We talk about it in this episode. Go check it out at mindpumpmedia.com. It is a HIIT program, so your workouts are 15 to 25 minutes depending on your level of fitness.
You also talk about MAPS Prime in this one, too.
I do mention MAPS Prime as well. These programs and information on these programs can all be found at mindpumpmedia.com.
T-shirt time!
T-shirt time, and we had 40 reviews.
40?
40.
So we called for them last
week. That's almost as old as Sal.
Yes.
Yeah. technically, crazy. It's older, but whatever.
So we're giving away 10 shirts.
That's a record right there, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
Wow.
So starting with Sam Ho 216, JW 3571, Beth 5.0, Jimmer Hammy, Pre-Workout Suck 69, Jacqueline Fitch.
Gotta add that 69.
Schlagermeister, Rich EW3, Lynn Marie Church, Yaz Chronic. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes@mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Those definitely sound like listeners.
Fire it up before you go.
Damn.
Huh? I'm going to leave Adam there going solo. Oh, yeah.
He can do it all by himself, Justin.
I know. I have faith in him.
One of the people in the world that I would never write off is Adam. So I feel like if he'd
when put his mic. When it's t-shirt time,
yeah.
I count on
oh
Adam
my God,
every
dude.
Time.
Yeah. T-shirt time. Can you not scream loud?
Yeah, I don't know if I can, actually.
When you get in big fights with, like, Katrina, do you ever yell?
No, I'm not a yeller at all. In fact, that's a non-negotiable for me.
Me too, I hate that.
I've been in relationships, no joke. I could have been dating a girl for 9 months to a year and a half, and if she, like, snaps on me like that or yells or screams or raises a hand or does anything like that, like, literally.
Oh, like, go kick rocks.
No, like, packing your bag for you, setting it out on my front. I've done this. Yeah. Like, you're gone. Like, that's it. Like, the fact that you would ever let it escalate to a point like that with me,
right,
just doesn't.
You're emotionally unstable.
And I know that I'm probably a little more extreme with that because of how I grew up. So I'm very, very,
you,
like,
recognize
sensitive
it
to it.
Yeah, very.
I can't stand it either. I feel like it's a very primitive, you know, just non-intelligent way of communicating. Like, you know,
it's awful.
You're gonna scream.
It's like a Nathaniel, dude. Yeah. I just feel like it's you. You know, anybody who understands anything about communication knows that when two people are angry and yelling at each other, no matter what you say, nothing is effectively communicated or received by the other person. So what the fuck is the point?
Well, yeah, yeah. Like, nothing was resolved.
And I'm not immune to getting that angry, right? I'm not immune to getting so angry that I want to.
No, it's a normal thing.
Right. So if I ever feel myself get that angry, I just leave. I just leave the situation.
Let's wait till later.
Yeah, wait till later till I can calm down,
gather
my thoughts.
But a lot of times that makes people more like pissed off, you know, because they want to, like,
yeah,
get a reaction.
They want to engage. But I'll even say that. I was like, you obviously want to engage in a fight right now, and I'm just not going to do that with you. So we can talk later when we're both ready to communicate this, and I'll just walk away.
That's a tough one.
Yeah.
That's a tough one. Yeah, I mean, hitting is fine, but yelling, I wouldn't. You know what I think?
Throne breaking stuff.
I have a theory. I think, and I may be wrong, but here's my theory. I wonder if women are more likely to yell in arguments than men are because of the, like, you ever seen women at bars will get in a guy's face because they know socially the guys
can't do anything.
Yeah, like very rarely do you see men do that to each other because there's always that threat of violence.
Right.
Like, if you get in a guy's face in a bar and you're a man, you're doing so knowing that this could very well turn out into a physical fight and I'm kind of asking for it, whereas, you know, the societally speaking, women know, like, oh, this guy's not going to do anything because we're in public, and if he does, everyone's going to destroy him. Type
this is where, like, I love Bill Burr because, like, he covers a lot of this in his stand-up, you know, and it's just like that whole thing. Like, you know what a punch in the face feels like, you know, whereas sometimes, you know, that, like you said, they keep antagonizing the fight where it's like, no, don't, you know, but they don't have the same consequence that's staring right back at
so
them.
So I have a friend who, female, and I was talking to her one day and she's like, most terrifying thing happened to me yesterday. And I'm like, well, what happened? She's like, well, this guy cut me off in his car. So I pulled up next to him and I flipped him off and we started yelling at each other back and forth, and so I didn't let him merge, and I almost ran him off the freeway because he pissed me off. And then he followed me, and then I got into traffic and he opened the door and tried to get out of his car, and I was freaking out, and I wanted to tell her, like, not that you deserve, like, any kind of, like, physical whatever, but I told her, like, what the fuck did you, like,
why did you provoke that?
Stop, like, don't engage in that shit. You know what I mean? What do you think? People are going to be, like, super cool with you just because you know what I mean?
Like, oh man, you got me.
You're small. Yeah. You're smaller than me. I'm not going to freak you. You know what I mean? No. They might get aggressive.
Well, there's definitely, I definitely think there's women that understand that and that use that to their advantage. I mean, I grew up in a home that was much like that. I grew up in an abusive home, and not so much abusive to me, but abusive to each other as far as my mom and my stepdad. And I was the oldest. So when I got older, you know, when you're young, you kind of gravitate towards your mom, and you, whatever mom says, if mom says that he's an asshole, he's a bad guy, and so you want to blame him. But as I got older, I was in the middle of a lot of the fights. I was the one separating them or talking to the cops when they showed up to the house. And much of the fights that I saw that my parents had that went physical was my mom antagonizing my stepfather. I mean, I've literally seen her chase him around the house with a frying pan or a knife. And, you know, he'd run into the bathroom and lock himself in the bathroom from her, and then trying to yell at her with the door cracked open and her punching him through the door. Like, So I've seen my mom do some shit that it's like, fuck, what? I mean, not, he has no right to touch you or put hands on you, but at the same time too, like, nor do you, you know what I'm saying? Like, where do you draw the line for her? And, you know, she got to a point where once they had a record, this was really dirty, right? Once the cops have been called out a few times on domestic violence like that, you know, he gets his strikes. And so once my stepdad had two strikes, you know, one more strike on domestic violence like that, he'll go locked up for a long time. So my mom knew that. And so she would antagonize that all the time. She would fuck with him. And then when the fight would get really crazy and escalated, she'd grab the phone and she'd look at him like, take a step further, motherfucker, and I'll call right now. And you're going to go to jail for 2 years plus, you know. So she used to do that. So she could totally fuck with him all she wanted. And once he had that, I saw one time, I'll never forget this fight, where my mom had bruises all up and down her forearms. And she had bruises because she was swinging at my stepdad, and he had his arms up over his head, covering his head the whole time, and her forearms are colliding with his. And so she had all these bruises. When the cop showed up to the house, that, you know, she had blamed all the bruises on him for hitting her.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, one of his strikes came that way. Yeah, right. So, you know, and that's not to say that all women do that at all.
No.
I would never.
Never
say that. But I think,
I don't think it's ever okay to, here's the thing too. I don't just extend this to women. I don't think it's okay to physically assault anybody that you know you can physically dominate. Unless you're defending yourself. When you defend yourself, everybody has a right to defend themselves. So, yeah. You know, a 12-year-old kid with a knife, you know, comes at me, you know, they could hurt me with a knife, even though they're a 12-year-old kid.
Right.
So I have every right to lay them out. Right. So that, of course, always. But I also think there's that, you know, you have to be, you have to be able to judge, like, okay, like, I know this person's yelling at me, but they're way smaller, I'm way bigger, and as annoying as it is, I'm not going to physically assault this individual unless I have to defend myself. And even then, I would use a force that is, I guess, justifiable. Like, if I need to block, like, if a little kid's going to hit me and I don't defend myself with full force, right? Mm-hmm. I might block with my hands or something like that. So, but that's up to the individual. So I get all that. But yeah, man, no, yelling in general. I know that it exists for a reason, and it's effective in some cases, but when you're arguing with another adult or talking about things, I don't see how yelling helps for the most part. I feel like it only escalates it and turns it into something where there's no more communication. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Right.
Now it's just who's louder.
Usually, I mean, from my experience, it's people that they can't like articulate what they want to say. And so that's like they get frustrated because it's like, well, they're not receiving what I want them to receive. So I'm just going to overpower them by raising my voice.
Dude, I grew up there was no abuse in my household. At least I don't know if it can be classified as abuse, because
it was verbal abuse
too. But dude, in my parents' culture, it is, yelling is, like, that's a part of the culture. Like, everybody yells.
Oh, yeah.
All the time.
I've been at, have you ever been at, like, your friend's house and, like, their parents get into it? Oh, man, so awkward.
Those were my parents, bro.
Yeah.
I would have been at your house, like,
I was like, a kid. Oh, shit.
So embarrassing, dude. That was one of the hardest things about having friends growing up was, like, it was, my parents fought so much that it was inevitable that if I had a best friend over, which is also why those that have been with me since, like, early years are like family to me, because I spent a lot of times over there. Like, if all of a sudden my parents were acting crazy, it was like, oh, pack my bags, I'm going to go spend the night at my best friend's house for two or three nights.
Mm-hmm.
And that became a very normal thing. But many, many nights and days where I had friends over and we're playing video games, and all of a sudden frying pans and fucking picture frames are getting thrown across the house and shit. And I'm like, talk about so embarrassing. Damn. Being like a kid in junior high or high school, like, trying to explain that, you know, to...
So now you have extremely low tolerance for yelling.
Oh, extremely low. Yeah.
that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, and I like that, dude. And I'm sure I probably launched a couple girls pretty early without...
prematurely.
Prematurely.
I was trying to call a cab. You raise your voice.
Right.
Get out of my house. Yeah.
You're wearing headphones.
Yeah. But hey, all the worth it, because I probably would have never made my way to meeting someone like Katrina, who is just on another level when it comes to communication. I mean, I think that, you know, we are the same person when it comes to, like, our beliefs with that, and neither one of us. We could be and we've been mad at each other, 100%. Like, we're 7 years deep. Of course, we've had our disagreements, but it'll be more of a intellectual battle back and forth, you know, so it won't turn into screaming and yelling.
Anyway, so what'd you guys do after we got, because we traveled like crazy 2 weeks in a row, right? Went to LA. Yeah.
So I
did Tampa. Were you guys exhausted?
I was exhausted.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
I was exhausted. That night we got home. So we rolled in. God, what was it, like 11 o'clock at night when we got home?
Yeah, finally. I actually waited for my wife to get off work. So that way, and then she ended up, I ended up getting off there at like 11:30, I think, that we finally left. So yeah, it was a long night.
Yeah, it was a real long night. And then that next morning, I got up, had breakfast with Katrina, had a few hours to kind of hang out with her, and then I was off to Dublin to hop in a limo and head over to Oakland. Where
for the game or whatever, your buddy?
Yeah, my buddy took 20 dudes to the OKC and the Warrior game, and he rented a suite and did it all up. And
nice.
Yeah, that was quite the experience.
Just throwing it down, huh?
Yeah, I guess he won a big settlement. He had he got injured at work and literally lost half of his foot. This has been going on for like 4 years. And forever he's been telling us, like, I'm going to get this big lawsuit. And obviously it hit because he rolled up with this, you know, stretched Hummer. And
this sounds like Office Space. Remember the jump to conclusions?
Oh, yeah. Well, I just keep
thinking. He's selling everybody on the idea that he wins the settlement.
I just keep thinking of the worst dad joke of all time. Like, he can go up to a girl and be like, hey, I got half a foot. She's like, oh my God. Oh, my God. Take a shoe off.
Stop.
That's fucked up. That's fucked up. We spent 2 days in the city. We went up to San Francisco.
I saw that Haight Ashbury and the
we went
museum.
To a, yeah, first we went to the
museum
De Young.
Time, huh?
Oh, dude, you know how happy I am that I have a girlfriend that likes doing the same shit that I like doing? Because I love...
Makes it easier.
I love going to museums. I love staring at art. I love just sitting and imagining the time period it was made and examining, you know, what it took to make it. And I could spend no problem 8 hours easily in a museum. And when I first met Jessica, she's like, oh, I don't know if I like museums or whatever. We went to one once and she's loved it. So it was her suggestion. So we went over there and spent all day in the De Young Museum, which is like art. And then they had African art and, you know, Pacific art. And it's really cool looking at some of these things to see the... Because you can see how different the culture was and their belief systems that created some of this stuff. It was really fascinating, really, really fascinating stuff. So we did that. And then the next day we went up to the Haight and just hung out there and went inside the shops and had some stuff. So we had a good time, man. Oh, I forgot to tell you guys on the plane, on the way back, did you guys, God, I felt so bad for her. There was this woman sitting in front of me.
Heavy set one?
Really big.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, she was a really big woman, and she was in the aisle seat.
Uh-huh.
And
everybody bumped her every time.
Well, she was so big that, you know, half her body was in the aisle, basically, or at least a quarter of her body was in the aisle.
She was young, too.
She was a really young girl. She was probably a teenager.
I thought 20s.
Maybe 20?
Yeah, yeah. She's in her 20s.
But, you know, the armrest that goes down? Mm-hmm. She had it up because she couldn't sit in her chair if the armrest was down. Mm-hmm. And the stewardess comes by and is like, ma'am, you're going to have to put that armrest down because I guess that's FAA, you know, regulations or whatever.
Mm.
So she had to stand up out of her chair, push the armrest down, and then...
Squeeze in. I did not see that. No way.
Squeeze in so that it was like cutting into her fat. Yeah, so that... Like, you could see, like, her body fat was pouring over it.
Yeah.
Because she was sitting in there. And, you know, I felt terrible. And a lot of people listening are like, well, it's her fault because of her whatever. Yeah, I get that. Look, I tell you what, 99% of the shit that happens to you in your life is because of stupid decisions you made, too. You know what I'm saying? So hers is just obvious. It's visible.
Yeah. Right.
But most of the pain that we feel when something bad happens is our own fault, too. So I don't, you know, I'm not angry or whatever, and I'm not like, what, you know,
bottom line
indifferent,
is,
but I felt really bad. I was watching her. It was a long flight, too, you know?
Bottom line is many, many people, most people, are self-sabotage in one way or another. And, you know, when you see somebody like that, I just see that the way that she's done that is through food, you know? Like, so that is whatever pain or whatever whatever she is covering up, it, you know, she's done it through food. And
I wish I wanted to sit next to her because I feel like if I sat next to her, I could somehow open up a conversation where it could lead to what I do for a living, which then could maybe have her ask me some questions and I could help her a little bit or show her some compassion, some empathy. But you, I mean, I can't just walk up to somebody, right? Like, how would you, excuse me?
Yeah.
You know,
I noticed you're really fat. Yeah. So we were wondering if I could help you out. I'm a trainer.
I have a fitness podcast. Very well. But I was sitting behind her and she had a carry-on bag or whatever, and she pulls her backpack from under the seat, you know, in front of her. And I could tell she was stressed out because she had to put the armrest down. And so people were kind of like watching or whatever. So she reaches down, pulls out the backpack, opens it up, and I could see through the crack in the chairs. She had in there a full thing of Oreos. She had a bag of Cheetos. And it was a backpack of snacks. And she just started eating them because obviously she's embarrassed,
stressed, and all that.
Dude, yeah, that's a coping mechanism. If I could only have talked to her. But
wow, I didn't even catch that, dude. I didn't even know. I mean, I saw the girl, but I didn't even see all that happen. That's fucking crazy.
Well,
that's
it thing, is, man.
It's just the empathy, you know, but at the same time, so you want them to just like buy into another way to approach, you know, stress and things that are happening in their life. And so it's really about the psychology, which we always try to bring up.
She's an addict, a drug addict. Tough, it's just with food, you know, but the complexity of the issue, we don't appreciate, or most people don't appreciate, how complex the issue is. It's no different than you seeing a homeless person who's tons of alcohol and you think, oh, I could totally help fix that person with a couple things. Not really. It's a very complex situation.
Oh, yeah.
When you're that big, it's very complex. It's not as easy as...
They've already spiraled to that point, right? Yeah. So how do you... It takes a lot of work, a lot of time to unwind from that.
Oh, you don't put that on even in 1 year, dude. Years.
It's a lot of work in that direction.
She's so young.
Yeah. You know what I wanted to ask you, Sal? I saw when I walked into work today on the our sponsorship board that we have Green Chef coming up.
Dude.
And I know you... Now, did you try some, Justin, or just you, Sal?
I haven't tried it yet, but I'm really excited to do it based off of like how they organize it, they make it so simple. So
I know Taylor has been working on this sponsorship for some time now, and I've been really excited
about
it.
So we've been approached by, I think, if I'm counting right, like 3 or 4 meal prep type companies, okay? And I hate meal prep companies because here's why. I get the convenience. I understand that it's convenient. You get food delivered to your door. Many of them are already made, so you just got to warm them up. But I don't... The quality is always terrible. Every single one I've ever tried, I eat it, and I look at the ingredients. I'm like, this is terrible, terribly sourced chicken or fish. The food is not organic.
It's usually just bodybuilder driven.
It doesn't taste good.
Yeah, they're all designed to fit your macros and be convenient.
That's it. It's just not good quality. So I don't want to talk about it. Well, Green Chef, so Taylor had them send us some samples and I took some home. So a couple things. First and foremost, they are mostly organic.
Like 90% organic.
Yeah, so their goal is to be 100% organic. They have paleo options, they have vegan options, they have keto options, they have
carnivore options.
I mean, basically whatever diet that you can think of, they have options where you can pull from, which I think is great because I'm difficult.
Like, now the big difference too is that, I mean, all those other food companies, it's frozen food. Now this food,
it's fresh
and you cook it yourself.
So here's what I did. So I took the samples and I went home and I expected, because it came in a box, right? I expected it to be like prepared food already. But I open it up and that's not what it is. What they've done is they've taken meals and they've given you all the measured amounts of the ingredients and very simple instructions to cook the food yourself. So you're looking at spending, it took us about 15 to 30 minutes. So Jessica comes home, we open up the box and we're like, oh shit, let's go ahead and give this a shot and cook it together. Best date ever. Like, cooking with your partner is one of the best ways to connect, and it's a very sexy date when you're cooking together. You're getting your hands dirty, you're making something together, you're tasting things, you're feeding food to each other.
You're pinching each other.
Then you get to, you know, feed each other out. We were playing music, we were having a glass of wine while we're doing it.
Wow.
So it's not so prepared that you just warm it up in the microwave, but it's also not like here's your recipe list, you got to go to the store, get all the ingredients. It's all in there for you. You just prep it.
Right, because that kind of kills the mood. I could totally see this because somebody that's like horrible, right, at cooking, like myself, I usually just hang out in the kitchen to talk, you know, to moral support. But yeah, this will actually help me to interact a little bit more with my wife. It'll be pretty
cool. Then the food was really fucking good.
All right.
It was like legit amazing food. So,
well, you know what you're paying for, because obviously they're priced a little bit higher than
totally worth it.
Your average, you know, pre-prepared meals that you would order like this. But I mean, you're not going to get it fresh. You're not going to get it organic like this. I mean, you're not going to get it all
delivered to your door.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. I was excited. I remember when he first showed me the company, and I know we've been talking to him for a while, and I walked in, I saw on the board that, you know, it's official now that we're doing Green Chef. I was pretty excited, and I knew I haven't had a chance to eat it yet, so I'm excited to get some.
So the way I want to use it is when we want to eat out
or travel, dude.
Or travel, but let's say
start having them send it ahead of time to our
the houses.
Yeah,
for sure. That's 100% would be a great idea. But I like this one. It's like, you know, we want to eat out, but there's not too many restaurants that, you know, we really like that have good quality food, or it's super expensive. Like, what a great option, like Friday nights or Saturday nights, or, you know, two nights a week, whatever, we get Green Chef and we prepare these meals together and then we feed the family. So,
hell yeah. Cool,
really,
man.
Really, 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 really impressed with them. So I'm glad we're working with them. You know what else I want to bring up? I thought this was hilarious. Was like when we were on the plane, Adam. And you and I think we were sitting in the same row, and it was super packed. So it was like a busy ass flight. Everybody's tired or whatever. And there was that dude that kept asking people if he could trade with them so he could sit next to his fiance.
Justin. Justin, dude. This is where Justin and I are a lot alike, dude. Yeah. Justin, no hesitation. No.
Yeah, no, bro. Like, okay, so let me give you guys my perspective.
You were such a dick the
way
you said
it. I was a dick. But you know what? To be honest, like, I smelled like entitlement all over this guy and like this lady. Like,
you smell entitlement,
dude. Literally, their only objective with that is to sit next to each other. You know how many flights like I've done with my wife where like we didn't get it organized, but we sat in fucking middle seats and toughed it out. You know what I mean? Like, that's your only excuse, is like, you want to sit next to your wife. You know, like. You know, tough it out. Anyway, so I flew to Tampa in a middle seat already, dude. And so I'm like, I give him the benefit. I'm like, do you have a window seat or do you have an aisle seat? And he's like, oh, no, man. So you're saying like I need to now move from my seat to your middle seat so that way you can sit next? Like, no.
Yeah.
Sorry. You know, move on.
Justin's all, no, I already sat in the middle seat on the way over there.
Fuck, so, dude. Yeah. You guys remember, I mean, I remember when I talked to this was years ago.
Maybe I'm not that nice anymore.
Well,
because you said that, and then Adam, me and Adam look at each other, and Adam's like, he's all smiling because it makes him happy.
That's my boy.
You know, and I'm thinking in my head, like, maybe she has anxiety, needs to sit next to her husband. I don't know, you know, what the deal is. Maybe they're just being assholes.
No, I don't. But then,
of course.
Somebody shined in that moment, right?
Doug gave it up?
Yeah.
Doug
oh,
did it.
Oh, dude. Doug
which is a great thing on his part.
Doug's a pushover.
But at the same time, here's the other, like, double-edged sword to that move, Doug. I had to sit next to them the whole rest of the flight after doing that. So that was a little bit awkward.
After you told them no?
Yes.
That's so awkward.
Yeah,
you told them no?
I was in the aisle seat and they fucking sit right next to me that whole time, bro. That was like, they wouldn't make eye contact with me. You know, I could hear a little, you know, a little fucking, like, whatever.
Doug's the guy. If we were all like, it's like the end of times and there's like scarcity of food and stuff like that. Doug's a guy who I would like try and angle on to get his food, you know?
You would angle on him?
Yeah, I would. I'd be like, Doug, I haven't eaten.
I'm glad you warned me.
We all know what you're
doing. I guilt him into giving me some more food.
But see, now the universe, like, so he ends up sitting next to some lady that, you know, they had a little flirty thing all the way back.
Oh,
right?
Doug.
That worked out, right?
What was that all about?
You made a Southwest connection, huh?
Yeah. You were talking forever to that lady.
Well, she was very interested in what I was doing. So I was editing a show, and she was very curious what I was up to. So I told her all about it, and then I went deep into what Mind Pump was all about, and I think she's very interested in the show.
Or you.
Right.
or me, or both.
I think it was the Doug effect.
Or Dougie Fresh. How about when we were at Tampa and we were sitting down at that restaurant and the two moms, the nurses, so they weren't medical insurance.
God.
We get there and we're waiting in this little lobby to go eat, right? We're sitting out in a restaurant, we're waiting to be seated, and there's this little lobby area or whatever, waiting area before you go get seated. And we sit down in this little area, and there's only a couple chairs, and these two ladies and this young kid, young kid's probably 18 to 20 years old, sit down. And these two girls obviously are attracted to Justin. You can just tell by the way they're communicating back and forth, and they're all into talking to us. And, you know, the boy gets up and kind of like walks away. And it didn't make sense to me. I actually thought that he was they were closer in age, because they struck me as only like in their 30s or so. And I thought he was 20, so I thought maybe they were friends. But it was the son, and you could tell he was irritated with his mom, who was obviously...
Dude, she was trying to get some, bro.
She was totally...
They were, first of all, they were smashed.
Yeah.
They were really, really drunk.
Oh, yeah.
And she's like,
drinking.
So what do you guys, you're fit. And I'm like, whoa, lady. Calm down. Calm down. Why don't you guys sit with us? And all of us collectively ignored that.
Oh, yeah.
She said that.
Yeah.
We're like, no one's answering.
Yeah.
No, we'd rather not sit with you.
No,
dude, did you, so check this out. Study just came out. How would you like to reduce the amount of days you get sick throughout the year by over 54%.
That's a big deal.
Yeah.
Big deal, right?
Duh.
So one of the factors is regular exercise, which everybody does if you listen to Mind Pump or you're on the show, right? You're one of the hosts. But here's the other one. The other factor accounts for 29% of that. That's taking cold showers. They found that taking...
Really? Dude, what did I tell you guys? The biggest... One of the biggest...
I did that for a while and I stopped.
Dude, I used to... Do you remember the first year when we were together? The very first year, I was sick on a... I've always been sick, and I've always just attributed that to being in the fitness industry, sweaty people, hot boxes, touching weights, being around a lot of people. Right. It's just
all
like,
the bacteria you're exposed
to. It's inevitable. Yeah. I'm going to get sick. When we got into doing the hot cold dips, it was a fucking game changer for me.
It's one of those things, man.
Ah, see? I knew it.
Listen, it's one of those things. When you see something that exists cross-culturally and it's been around for thousands of years,
it's for a reason.
There's something there. It's no different than humans having a feature on their body that they evolved to have. The reason why we evolved to have particular features isn't because we mutated and created these new features. It's because those features were left over and they evolved. They lasted because they were valuable, right? Cultures have practices that last thousands of years and don't go away because they're valuable. Doing cold shower, cold dip, cold contrast has been around for a long time. In Eastern European nations, it's still a major part of their culture. I could pull up videos right now showing school children running out. Well, they'll do it as part of their daily practice when it's snowing outside. The kids will put bathing suits on. Mm. They'll let them. They'll have them run around in the snow, play with snow, and dump cold water on themselves. Children, they do this with babies.
It sounds like torture, but yeah, it's awesome.
No, the kids are having fun and playing.
I know, it's crazy.
Nobody's forcing them. You can pull them up on YouTube, and I've been doing it now for a while, and I get a legit. But now we have a study to show that the cold by itself in this particular study, 29% reduction in sick days. That's a big fuck. There's no medication that will do that.
Well, just these environmental changes and your ability to react to them appropriately is something you have to keep training, right? So it just makes perfect sense that if you're like getting exposed to a little more extreme hot, a little more extreme cold, that your body is going to be more resilient.
Obviously, when we talk about cardiovascular system, the central nervous system, we talk about all these other systems of our body that are, it's so important to train them. Why would it not be this way too?
Yeah, it's so logical.
It is so logical. And if there's ever a system that we neglect the most, this, our temperature. I mean, when in history did you ever see this ability to, in your house, keep it at 72 degrees. By the time you get in your car, I mean, I have the push start now. You know, I push start my car before I even get into it. You know what I'm saying? So it's warmed up to just the temperature I like, because I only want to be cold for the 30 seconds of walking from my door to the... I mean, that's where... And then we get to our studio where it's climate controlled again. It's like, fuck, we don't ever deal with that anymore.
No.
Yeah. Especially somewhere here in California.
No, there's something to be said about strengthening your body and making it more resilient through... If your body becomes more resilient, it becomes generally more resilient. So, and you'll notice this when I do cold showers or when I do, you know, sauna or contrast, if I haven't done it for a while, I notice that I'm less resilient to it. You know what I'm saying? Like it's harder for me to handle it. But if I do it consistently, it's like I'm strengthening my ability to handle the changing temperatures, well, that's making my body more resilient. No different than when you work out in the gym and you just get started, you have a low tolerance for intensity, a low tolerance for, you know, duration of workout or speed or whatever. But as your body adapts, it becomes stronger and more resilient. And that resilience that you build from working out makes your body more resilient to withstanding, you know, illness.
Yeah.
So it only makes perfect sense.
So we just need the cold portion. We got the sunlight and sauna, which you got to use, right, Adam?
Yeah, yeah. No, that's, and which that's a, the infrared sauna is a trip. Have you guys haven't had a chance to use
not
it
yet? Not
yeah,
this I can't one. Wait.
So it's really, you really different, right? It's not like a normal sauna at all. And it took,
it's infrared heat.
Yeah, really different. Which is totally different than what I expected. It's not what I anticipated at all. And what I find fascinating is you could totally have your phone in there. You can have anything in there. It's not going to get all, you don't get this like moisture buildup. The way the waves work, and it doesn't heat the room as much as it heats your body up.
The temperature of tissue.
Yeah, so that's the wavelengths, and there's far and near infrared waves in all those heaters inside there, or lights inside the sauna, and each of them project off a different either near or far infrared, and it like heats up your core temperature. So you'll be sitting there inside the sauna and it doesn't really feel too hot. It never gets so hot where it gets unbearable. Like, so you know, some steam rooms or saunas, if you've been in there for a while, you're like,
can't breathe.
It's unbearable after
right, it's unbearable. You can't breathe anymore. You want to get out because the air is so hot. The air doesn't get all hot inside of this thing, but your body, I mean, after about a half hour, I was like dripping in sweat. So it's pretty fascinating.
Sweet.
We just got to get what we don't have in ours yet, and we have it. I haven't figured out how to hook it up yet. Is, you know, we have the TV, the DVD player, the, you know, it can hook to Pandora, Spotify up to
dude,
it.
Dude, there's a fucking TV in there.
Hey, that's awesome.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, so rad.
We got the Cadillac.
Did you do it with, you and Katrina both used it?
Yeah, we used it. So the plan was for her and I to come here on Saturday morning.
Were you guys naked?
No, we didn't do it. Oh, okay. Yeah, not okay. The first time.
Okay.
Whoa. We got in there to, I wanted to go in and read a book and sit in there with her. So, or I'll listen to a book. So it has Audible on it. So our Audible account, all you have to do is put your username in it. So we're at our Audible account on there. And then, but for some reason, the speakers aren't working. So I don't know if when the guys set it up, they didn't connect the speakers. I got to do a little bit of homework.
But you're supposed to be able to, right? You're supposed to be able to listen to music.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, we have a stereo.
It's a super quality one. The one they sent us is
Cadillac. I think we have the Cadillac of all of them. Like, it's the one of the most roomy ones. You could fit three people in there probably comfortably. Mm. It's really nice for two.
Podcast.
Yeah, no,
let's do a podcast out of there.
Yeah. We totally could, actually. So that's why, back to like how it doesn't really heat up in there. You could put gear in there. It'd be fine. My phone doesn't overheat or anything in there.
Oh, that's rad.
Yeah, we could totally podcast
that's
in there.
That's super rad.
It would be kind of funny to do that.
So I got some more news for you. So they just did, scientists at Johns Hopkins University have found that there's lead, arsenic, chromium, manganese, and nickel in the vapor of vaping of e-cigarettes. Heavy metals in there, and we know that that persistent inhalation of those have been linked to all kinds of cancers and lung, liver, immune, cardiovascular damage, brain damage, and even cancer. And here's the crazy part. You know what else does all those things? Cigarettes.
Yeah.
So basically, it's funny because I read these articles and you know the tobacco industry's like, they're the ones that love promoting this shit. I'm like, vape cigarettes are bad for you.
Yeah.
You know what else is bad? Yeah. You're selling cancer sticks, of course. Yeah. But yeah.
That's crazy.
But it's not the vapor from these things, apparently, that they're testing isn't that much better for you. I don't know if they're comparing them head to head, you know what I mean? I mean, what do you guys think of that? Because I see a lot of kids now with these.
So this is vaping tobaccos.
Yeah, you've seen them, right? About. Where they do the big old cloud of vape or whatever.
Yeah.
And it looks like a steampunk looking vape pen, you know?
I think it's a trend that will die. I think it's
you don't think it'll because I've seen way more of them than cigarettes in California.
Yeah,
around here.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's gonna last that long. I think I already see people talking shit about it already. It was like a cool thing for like a short minute, and then now it's already like a trendy hipster dorky thing to do now. So, I mean, I guess if you were somebody that was a heavy smoker and it's helped you out as your transition away from cigarettes, then I can be pro it. But it seems to be like the new thing that all the, you know, 17-year-olds to 20-year-olds are hopping on as like the new smoking, right? It's now become the new smoke. It's healthier for you than cigarettes, so it's cool to do it, you know? So I think when everyone starts realizing that it's not that much healthier for you to do it, and not only that, but it looks stupid.
Well, smoking that robot.
Here's the thing: like nicotine has got some, you know, clear effects on the brain and body. It's actually a, and I hate saying this because I know people are going to be like, "Cool, I'm going to go try it." Nicotine has got nootropic properties. It does, and it actually has some brain protective properties for things like Alzheimer's, dementia. No joke. Now, it doesn't mean you go use nicotine to get those potential benefits, because the negatives of the fact that it's addictive as shit, it definitely outweighs it. But there's a reason why back in the day, people would smoke when they'd work really hard, because the nicotine has got that. And we have friends that, who is it that uses the chewing tobacco? Is it Kyle?
Yeah.
Kyle Kingsbury and all those guys over at Onnit.
Organic tobacco they use and all that kind of
stuff. Yeah, they're saying it's better for you or whatever, but it's still addictive, you know? Yeah. But it's got those nootropic properties where... So I'm wondering if the whole biohacking community is going to start
chewing,
well, promoting that, right?
Well, you see,
I could see it.
You see all the Onnit crew over there. I mean, a majority of those guys are—they were all dipping, so they're all dipping. And I know that
people are just looking for something to use.
Yeah, I think it's more that, man. I mean, the real benefits you're getting from it are so. Come on, I mean, you're not getting much from
it. I don't necessarily feel great from. I don't smoke, of course, so maybe I have to get used to it. But if I take a drag of a cigarette, or definitely when I've tried. Chewing tobacco.
Makes me sick.
It's to my stomach.
Yeah.
Like terrible. Even cigarettes.
I could never do it.
Even cigarettes, the effect is not, I don't necessarily like it. But
oh, I liked it. When I went through my little smoking kick for a short minute there, I liked the effect of it. I hated the smell of it. That's what I didn't like.
Yeah.
So you can vape now.
Yeah. it's too much effort, dude. Too much effort. I'll stick to my roll and my joints every once in a while and having that to set the...
That's the thing about marijuana is they've tried to connect it to cancer forever and there is no connection.
Right.
And in fact, it has protective effects, but it's not because smoking is good for you, because smoking's bad for you. Regardless of what you're smoking, you are breathing in particulate matter. It's because
it's the counter.
Yeah, marijuana's got anti-cancer
properties.
There's cannabinoids in there that are anti-cancer. So it's.
I've tried to get negating it. Anybody that's a friend of mine that smokes cigarettes, I always try and put them on marijuana. I'm like, dude, if you're gonna smoke like that all the time, fucking get high. Yeah. Get high. At least
you don't have to smoke as much.
Yeah, you won't have to smoke. You won't smoke nearly as much, and it's a lot better for you. So if you got to smoke, because I think sometimes when you get these people that are addicted to smoking cigarettes, half of it is just the habit of
ritual.
It. Yeah, the ritual of puffing on it all the time. I know there's all the nicotine that can be very addictive in there also, but I definitely think that some of it's just the habit of going through the motions and smoking like that. Do you guys watch? March Madness at all? Do you guys watch? You guys
know what's going on?
I mean, I used to.
I know it's basketball.
All the time.
Yeah. So it's college basketball, really, and it's coming up right now. This is all. I follow a lot of that stuff, so I enjoy.
Are the brackets already coming out? Like people filling them out?
No, that'll come out this coming week. Next week or two, you'll see all that stuff come out when the official brackets are announced. Right now, all the other tournaments that lead up to this tournament are happening. Oh, the reason why I brought it up. Was because I try and find topics with you guys that we can talk about that you don't need to be like a fucking smart sports guru to have an opinion on this. One of the biggest things in college sports right now that is highly debated is whether we should pay sports college athletes or not.
This has been a long going discussion.
Yeah, and it's big right now. I don't know what came out recently in the news that prompted again, but all over your talk radios and sports talk is this whole argument on should we give a kid who's, you know, 18, 19 years old going to Duke University playing basketball, you know, should he get paid to go to school? What do you guys think of that? Do you think that
what are the arguments for and against it? What are they saying?
So here's some of the things that when you don't, this is some of, so a lot of schools, most schools, okay, especially big schools, pay players under the table. So let's say,
I was just gonna say, because I feel like,
so let's say there's let's say the best basketball player in the country in high school right now, it happens to be some over here in California at some high school, and Duke University, North Carolina, all your big basketball schools see that. And so they're all going to be recruiting this kid. Well, you know, of course he's going to get a full ride scholarship. he's going to get a full ride scholarship to any of those schools. So a lot of the ways that some of these schools in the past had would get bribe this kid to come to school is, you know, oh, your parents are, you know, poor and this and that. Let us buy your mom a house. And they do a lot of and they can't give the kid money, right? Because back in the old days, it would be like a fucking
cash,
right? But that guy fucking. So now they have like these organizations, like so. Let's say you're part like I went to Duke University 30 years ago. There's, you know, alumni that, you know, that have money and wealthy and they love the sport and the game. And so they together put their money together and they provide nice things for these kids. So college life is a little uh-huh. better. Now, all that stuff is against the law. You can't do that. Mm-hmm. So and really the game has been for the last 30 years how to work around the system. Mm-hmm. The rules say you can't pay players. It's illegal to do that. Bottom line is these kids know that they're worth money, that they're the best of the best. I had buddies that were like D2 schools that got money and got paid to go.
Wow, so really?
Yeah.
I've experienced some of that with people around me, like superstars.
Right.
They find ways to incentivize them. One thing I wanted to bring up was John Calipari, I think his name is. He's the head coach for Kentucky. Do you know anything about his approach to all this? I thought it was like very interesting the way that he handles this with athletes coming in and out of his program because he actually attracts superstars. And so his approach is that his whole goal is to get you in the NBA as quick as possible. Mm. And so like all the rest of the coaches, like they can't stand that. They think that he's ruining the purity of
because they want to keep him in longer.
The sport. They want to keep him in longer, go through the whole program till they're a senior, you know, get them in on that end of it where he's like, no, fuck that. There's a time capsule that you have with performance with these athletes as far as longevity of their career, like opportunities, like something might happen and, you know, this
injury,
this talented, gifted athlete's not going to be able to actually get into a contract with the NBA. We're not paying them here in college. So, you know, the whole thing about like getting your education is one thing, but like an NBA contract is fucking miles away from.
Well, not only that, but the reality of it is that most of these guys aren't even, they're not going to school, bro.
No,
if you're going to Kentucky or you're going to Duke, you're going to North Carolina on a full ride scholarship, and you're a starter on the basketball team, your classes are you're majoring in cooking. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, like you're getting TAs
to do all your work. All that shit happens. Yes. Well, so I've seen it firsthand, and it's like it's a joke.
So yeah. I have two questions. One is there a limit, an age limit to get into the NBA?
You have to play 1 year of college.
So yeah. Only 1 year.
It used to not be that way.
They changed that because of people like him that have started to institute this where I forget what they call you know, his style of coaching.
It's like a farm system.
And this was an NBA rule. They said, okay, you have to play.
This is just recent. So that's only been going, I think, for 2 or 3 years now where we require, it might be a little bit longer.
So stupid. They're also in cahoots. Why? Mm-hmm. Why have that? So stupid.
Right. So,
we want the kids to go to school. You don't give a fuck.
Yeah, right.
You really don't give a shit. It's obviously.
No, they want your money.
It's obviously the college, the organization that manages the colleges. And I don't need to know anything about basketball.
This is what a lot of people are saying about the kids. So now imagine you're a kid, like you're a superstar kid on a team like Duke, like I'm saying, and your jersey, I mean, they sell fucking $1 million worth of your jerseys mm-hmm. in a year, you know, and the ticket prices are up because you're this superstar athlete and,
you're
you know,
on all the billboards,
yeah,
you're marketing,
right? So
you're selling all the tickets.
Yeah. Your name is already becoming marketable in college. If you're a big sports fan, especially, and that just goes for any sport. You know, one of the things we do is you follow college. You want to see who the up and coming talent is, mm-hmm. and you know, a lot of when we were younger, when we were in high school and college, like we would buy college athletes' jerseys. You know, so there's a lot of money that's being made off of these kids that's being distributed through all the coaches and the organization and the school. And so the argument is, you know, why are these kids not making that money? And now there are some of these kids that are helping produce, you know, all this revenue for the school because of their talent and their name, and they're struggling to get by financially or whatever. But then there's the other side of it too that I think a lot of these big superstar name guys and girls for these college teams are, you know, getting favors other places mm-hmm. or other ways.
The way I look at it is, if something's gonna happen, then making it illegal only forces it underground, and we don't get to see it. We don't get to air it out. So the way I think is let the schools pay them and let's see. Let's see what's going on, what's happening.
I
don't think, and here's the thing, people say, well, they'll be exploiting the players. Actually, that's the opposite. They're exploiting them now, if there is any exploitation, although it's all voluntary, so there is none. But right now, like you said, they're making money off of people who they're not paying, and the only reason why they're not paying them is because it's illegal to, because if there was no law that said colleges can't pay players, for sure they'd be paying them because that's how valuable they are.
Right.
And for people who are pissed off by that, because I know there's people listening right now, they're thinking, nah, fuck that, it's college, they're supposed to just be there for school, we want to keep it pure, then stop spending so much money watching the games, and then you'll see that the money will dry up and it won't be that way. But right. The reality is, it's got a massive pull. I personally don't watch sports, but I know people who don't even watch professional basketball. All they watch is college.
Right.
They actually say they prefer it. So
major business for like all these networks. Like look at Notre Dame football. You know, that's broadcasted to like every single state because right. they're such a popular team.
Right.
So, you know, it's mega business that they're making off of these kids. And so you got to consider that as if it wasn't like that, you know, if it's structured in a way or it was just this college is playing this college and then, you know, only our fans are watching, you know, and cheering against your fans. And that was all it was.
The funny part is different. That I don't think you ever could police it or even organize it the same way that you organize it, like with the NBA. And what I mean by that is like, okay, so let's say we opened up salary caps and each school was, you know, allowed to spend, you know, $100 million on contracts for athletes that are coming in. Even if you did organize it, you paid it, you still are going to have people that, like I said, the alumni that are part of Duke or North Carolina or these big schools that are going to pay on top of that or spiff these kids on top of that to make them sway. Because sure. if I can go to North Carolina or Duke, and now that we've decided, okay, we're going to allow these schools to pay them, but everybody has to be on an equal playing field, right? Because that's how you would do it. You wouldn't allow – it's not fair for Duke to compare or compete with Cal, you know, financially, because the amount of revenue they generate for their basketball team, you'll never be able to get a player there. So you have to put some sort of a salary cap on it to make it an even playing field financially. Mm-hmm. But even if you even that playing field out to where you could play,
yeah, pay still do players, the other shit.
Yeah, you're still going to have people that are. So, I mean, I think just let it all go.
I think they're athletes. I think they're athletes and they're adults. Right. So if they were children, I could see, okay, well, they're under 18. There's that argument, but they're adults. Yeah. They can choose to get a job. They can choose to do all these other things anyway. Like,
well, that's the other thing. How are they going to pay for anything? Yeah, like that was one of my arguments too. Like being an athlete in college, like you don't have time to get a fucking job. You know, the practice schedule, the amount of like video time and like preparation throughout the week, they own you. Like you don't have time to get a job and actually, you know, make any kind of a money so I can go out with my friends. And like, I had to have everybody pay for me to do shit.
I wonder if they fear like more corruption with allowing the money.
It would be less.
You think it'd be less?
Of course. If here's the thing. Do you get more corruption in drugs with drug prohibition or less? You know what I'm saying? Like more, obviously, because everything's forced underground.
Yeah, but I don't know if you can still compare those two. I get where you're going with that, but I don't know if you can compare
those. Well, I mean, is there more? I mean, okay, let's put it this way. Do you think there's more backroom deals and handshakes going on behind closed doors in college versus pro?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, well, there you go.
Yeah.
So I think it's still slimy. You probably can still see slime, but at least it'll be out in the open slime. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
No, I think they should. I think it's silly that they have those kind of rules. I think probably part of those rules probably come from, because it seems obvious to me from the little bit I know, so maybe you guys can correct me. The organization that covers college is what, NCAA?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
okay.
It's one of the main ones.
So
yeah.
that's the college organization that manages it. It seems to me like the NCAA and the NBA are partners, and I feel like the NBA probably doesn't want the NCAA to pay or to allow their schools to pay, right? Because then they'll be competing directly with the NBA. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I mean that could be. Could be, yeah. That's a good,
because think about the amount of money. And again, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm not as privy on this subject as you guys are, but from what I know, it seems like there's certain college basketball teams that generate more revenue than even some pro basketball teams. Like maybe the worst pro basketball team probably doesn't get as much, you know, sell as many tickets and jerseys and whatever, or have as much pull as a top college team, Would you, is that comparable? Would you say no?
It's comparable. That's a really good question because there's a lot of other
look at those numbers.
A lot of other factors with national TV getting involved because I mean most of your big college teams are most of college arenas are 4 or 5 times the size of what an NBA arena is.
Oh yeah.
So college arenas are fucking huge. Because you have all the student and faculty and everything like that that are coming,
money, everything.
Yeah. So,
so March Madness, is that the finals for college?
No, it's just it's a tournament that they do in college, right? Okay. So, and it's
what are the biggest college basketball?
It's March Madness.
Yeah, March Madness.
Yeah, yeah.
How does March Madness revenue wise compare to like NBA season and then NBA finals and stuff like that? It'd be a good thing to look up, right?
You would have to compare March Madness.
Think it's as big.
It's not as big. If you were to compare it's like
a playoff game or something.
The NBA, you'd have to compare the playoffs to March Madness and the playoffs for the NBA. I'm sure that it's a very good question. Though I would love to,
because I'm imagining right now if the
you bring a very good point up. What would be a problem? That's why I'm glad I brought it up to you guys, because even though
someone might be
you
like
don't know shit about sports,
yeah, like you might be a
you
sophomore.
Understand economics very well, so you understand that this is probably it is not in the NBA's best interest to have college, because then if you're an athlete, think about this: if I'm a college player, you know, going to a cool school like Duke or North Carolina,
and getting paid a shit ton,
and I'm getting paid good money, I don't want to leave.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't want to go to the NBA. But if I'm still
in the competition level is a little bit lower, so you're going to get more time on the floor, all that stuff.
And you're the man at school. Are you kidding me? I would want to leave college. If I'm the superstar at college,
that's what I'm saying.
I'm getting paid.
Like, you might not want to leave if you're a junior or sophomore and you're already getting paid shit tons of money. Or
make a lot of sense.
Or if you're playing for a top college and a pro team comes to you and says, hey, we want to pay you this much money. Now you can go to your college and be like, hey, they're trying to recruit me.
Yeah.
How much will you guys pay me to stay?
Right.
So let me ask you,
if there's a salary cap, you know, to the team, they would have to reorganize, get rid of some players.
So think of it this way. And again, correct me if I'm wrong. The NBA obviously is the basketball organization. If someone even with $10 billion tried to create a new basketball organization to compete with the NBA, they'd have a very tough chance, right? They probably would fail. We've seen people do this with the NFL.
Yeah.
Now imagine if the NCAA all of a sudden got turned into a pro league right away. Would they be able to show or at least have a chance at competing?
Yeah.
They would.
They would.
So I'm wondering if the NBA is the one that's like, hey, look, we don't want you guys to start paying if it's kind of like in cahoots, you know?
I don't know if they're in cahoots as much as they might be competitors.
Yeah,
the National Basketball Association is different. I think it's different than the NCAA.
They can get away with not paying them. You know, so it makes the school more profitable. Why would they want to pay their
Doug? Would you Google NCAA affiliation or connection to NBA?
You did say that there's a new rule in the NBA that you have to play 1 year of college before you can go there.
Right.
Yeah. That feels to me like the NCAA negotiated that. You know what I mean? Like they went to them and said, hey, we don't want to lose players. Maybe.
I don't know. That's
they might have. Yeah, because LeBron and Kobe came out early.
Kevin Garnett came out early.
Right.
A lot of these guys.
They skipped right past the college. So they must have seen potential in that. So that probably shook them up into reorganizing that idea and letting that be the new standard.
Well, think about it this way. If you're a college and one of your main money makers is sports, which it is, right? In some colleges, that is how they make a majority of their money is sports. I know this. And all of a sudden, you're seeing that kids are not even attending, or there's this trend where kids are wanting to go straight to pro. Mm-hmm. You're going to lose your cash cow. I would, if I was the head of the NCAA, I'd go to the NBA and be like, look, we feed you guys quite a bit. Like, I want you guys to make this rule that people have to stay for at least a year, because otherwise we're going to lose a shit ton of money. Yeah. It feels that way to me. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a valid thought, I think.
Yeah, so anyway. Hey, did Organifi stop making the Cacao Bliss?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just heard
Who else here is bummed about that?
I was drinking it last night, and I was thinking about that. I was like, this sucks. This might be my last
this
bottle.
This is like gold.
Well, so they're working on, I think, making their own version. I believe the person that makes the Cacao Bliss, they affiliated with them, and now that person went off to do something else. So now Organifi is creating a new, they're trying to work on something on their own. But so that sucks because I like the Cacao Bliss. Please don't get rid of the gold.
No.
The Organifi gold is by far the best. It's now become my favorite product.
It's amazing. One of my old clients, I got her on gold because of that whole ritual of bringing her, calming her body down. before, like making a ritual out of it at night to lower the anxiety levels, lower the stress levels. And she's been drinking consistently the gold,
and she likes
the turmeric and everything. Yeah, and she loves it. And the anti-inflammatory, you know, properties it has to it and everything has been real helpful. So,
I drink it with. I now mix my coffee with it because I like the way it balances out the caffeine. Because if I just have straight caffeine,
so it doesn't
sometimes
get you too jittery. Too
jittery. So yeah. I'm amped, but I'm smooth. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I don't get that weird anxious feeling sometimes I'll get from coffee if I push too much caffeine. Plus, the gold tastes freaking good in coffee, so it's a nice little additive. But yeah, don't get rid of that because that is now becoming the product that I use the most.
Yeah,
from Organifi, it was the green juice and that are the two I use the most. But I think the gold is the one that I'm using even more so than the green.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from Real Girl Real Budget. I was recently diagnosed with Hashimoto's. What is your opinion on the autoimmune protocol diet?
What's the do you know much about this?
So, anytime you're talking about a diet or a protocol that is for autoimmune issues, they revolve around, at least the ones I'm familiar with, revolve around eliminating foods that have high potential for intolerances. Mm-hmm. An elimination diet would be a way to individualize something like this. Whole 30 gets rid of a lot of common food intolerances. The carbohydrate specific diet, which people on Crohn's disease seem to be using a lot of, eliminates these types of things.
Have you had anybody with Hashimoto's before?
Definitely. Yeah,
oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So this is when the immune system basically attacks the thyroid. So it's becoming much more common. In fact, the thyroid is one of the more common
An autoimmune areas. That affects the thyroid?
It attacks the thyroid.
No shit.
Yeah, so sometimes people on Hashimoto's will need to, you know, they'll need to take, Synthroid or...
Now, is it...
How do you test for that? Do you know by levels of your
I'm sure they find out from the thyroid first and then they go back.
Here's what
right?
sucks.
Right,
sometimes,
I'm just curious, my wife, maybe.
Here's what sucks. You could have low thyroid and that could point to Hashimoto's, or it could be something else. Sometimes your thyroid is normal, but you just have lots of antibodies, and so your body's not utilizing the thyroid very well, and so there's further tests that you need to do. Sometimes there's a lot of undiagnosed potential, you know, thyroid issues where people's thyroid seem normal but they've got the symptoms of low thyroid. So they'll have the goiter, you know, where it kind of gets a little swollen in the throat. They'll have, you know, the side effects like, you know, coldness, slow metabolism, low energy. So it's kind of a, but they're getting better at identifying these types of things. But here's the thing about, you know, our opinion or my opinion on diets to help with autoimmune issues. Diets can help anything. What I mean by that is what you eat has a profound effect on your health. And so whenever, it's funny because who are we talking to? We were talking to somebody. Oh, I forgot who it was. It might have been Dr. Sean Baker where, where doctors will tell people like, oh, you know, it doesn't really matter what you eat, or, you know, you go to a doctor, you have inflammation or you have psoriasis or you have some other kind of chronic health issue. And then you tell the doctor, you know, what about changing what I eat? And they'll respond and say, well, you could try that, but, you know, almost like dismissive, like it's not going to make that big of a difference.
Yeah.
What you eat has a profound effect on your health. I don't understand why this is even...
I know. It's not even debatable. It's just like it's a reality.
Of course. Of course it does. Like, can you eat in a way that'll make you really sick? Yes. So the opposite is also very true. Can you eat in a way that will impact your autoimmune issue? Well, we know this. Western medicine knows this for a fact. Like... There's definitely things that they will have you avoid eating if you have certain autoimmune issues, but then they tend to stop right there and not say something like, you know, eat this particular way to benefit your body. Here's the thing with autoimmune issues. An autoimmune issue literally means that your body's immune system is attacking your body. And it can manifest in many different ways. Your immune system can attack your skin. It can attack your joints like rheumatoid arthritis. It can attack your pancreas and give you diabetes. It can attack your thyroid, in this case, Hashimoto's. It can attack your liver. It can attack your gut and give you Crohn's. It can attack your eyesight.
Well, I had a client just recently that had autoimmune issues. It wasn't Hashimoto's. I wasn't familiar with this one at all. And what do you think about this? This was my recommendation to her was, you know, she's a big fan of Thrive Market. She shops on there all the time. I was like, you know, literally just do the drop down for keto and follow and just eat the foods off of there for a while. And then let's see how your body starts to respond from there. And
keto
then,
or paleo.
Yeah, that's what I was telling her.
And the reason why those two seem to work really well for autoimmune issues. And I say seem because diet and autoimmune issues, there's still lots of research going on right now. But if you talk to gut health experts like Dr. Michael Ruscio, they'll tell you like, oh, there's definitely an effect. Paleo and keto tend to avoid completely the foods that people commonly have food intolerances to.
And I think that's a good point. I'm glad you made that point, because even when I said to her, I said like, we don't know for sure if this is not going to fix you. It's like, this is a great place to start though, by eliminating a lot of these processed.
Yeah, because any food can cause, exactly. Right. Any food can cause an immune reaction, and it's depending on the individual. But the most common foods that we find, that if somebody has food intolerances or has autoimmune issues, then eating foods that contain gluten, eating dairy, nuts, soy, corn, legumes, those tend to be the big ones, right? If you cut the egg whites is another one. If you cut those out, then you're typically going to remove most of the common problems. This doesn't mean you're going to be perfect, because there is a huge individual variance. But what happens when you eat foods that you're intolerant to, I'm not talking about an allergy, by the way, because an allergy is obvious. You eat a peanut, boom, you get an allergic reaction. When I eat something I have an intolerance to, it heightens my immune system. And so it makes it hypervigilant. And so I'm more likely to cause these autoimmune issues to become worse, or to get, you know, quote unquote flare-ups. Like Adam, you noticed this with your psoriasis,
right?
You know, what foods have you noticed for yourself?
Anything that I eat, that's if I eat anything in a wrapper or a box, it almost is guaranteed that I'm gonna see it. And I don't see it instantly. I see it after I've made the habit of doing it 2 or 3 days in a row. So if I've been really good at sticking to a whole foods type of diet and I've been consistent, and then I let myself go off track where I'm eating something out of a bag or a wrapper or a box, and then it's not right away, it's the second or the third day that I've allowed that in there, and then I see the flare up. So I haven't nailed it down to a specific food that is causing it. I'm not sure. I think I have several things.
Multiple.
I think I have multiple
things. It's almost always that way.
Right. I definitely, as much as I've played around with all the different types of foods, I haven't nailed it down to a specific food that I have. I can tell you this, okay, and I just did this the other day, so complete transparency. I was in the movie theater the other night watching Black Panther, and this is a recent thing that I've put together that I hadn't put together before. Now, this just confirms what I'm saying right now about the box or wrap or whatever. So I had a box of Mike and Ike's. Now, I grew up eating tons of fucking candy. I rarely ever eat candy now. And so occasionally when I'm watching a movie or doing something like that, it's like, oh, I haven't had one in a while. Like I'm gonna enjoy a box of my favorite candy or whatever. So I'm eating Mike and Ike's. And we're watching the movie. I eat at the beginning part of the movie. Well, I catch myself, and I do this like subconsciously. I don't even notice I'm doing this because I have psoriasis and all these different spots in my body. I'm all of a sudden picking at it while I'm watching the movie. And it didn't take but maybe a half hour, hour after I consume that. And so I'm noticing this now that, you know, it's hard to tell because I always have psoriasis. It's just either it's flared up really bad or it's suppressed. So sometimes it's hard to pinpoint like, oh, is it really flared up right now, or is it just kind of bad, or is it because of
this? You've been paying attention though.
Right, so I pay attention to it more now. And so I've been able to put together, like I have seen two things. I've noticed that if I have ice cream or if I have candy, if I have one of those two things, I do notice like I'll have this tendency to want to pick or scratch at it relatively quick, right? Like right after it, but within the hour or so, I noticed that I want to get at it. So I don't know though for sure what it is. I do know though any client that has battled either psoriasis or any other autoimmune issues that I've put on either a keto or a paleo type of a diet, 90%+ of them have seen success with that.
Yeah. So, and this reminds me of when we had Dr. Sean Baker on, who was talking about the carnivore diet and how he felt so good eating just meat.
Yeah.
And my belief, and this is my speculation, but my belief is that individuals like him, because there's actually a community of people who just eat meat, like that's all they eat, and they say they feel best doing it that way.
Mm-hmm.
My speculation, and I wouldn't mind putting money on this. I would definitely bet money on this, that these people are in such a hyperimmune state that they have so many autoimmune or so many intolerances to food that eliminating all of them except for the one that is the most nutrient dense and the one that is the least likely to cause autoimmune issues or intolerances, which mm-hmm. is red meat. Red meat's very nutrient dense. You could just eat that, not have a nutrient deficiency. You get your fats and proteins, which are essential macronutrients, that they feel best, not because their diet is great, but because they've eliminated all the stuff that is causing problems.
I remember you kind of proposing that, and then it just kind of went right over. But I definitely think there's something in that thought, because even like assessing myself and kind of trying to troubleshoot as to what the triggers are that set off, my acid reflux and this chronic issue I've been battling with forever. It's like, you know, just eating meat for a while for me, even personally, I feel like, I don't have the same response, like certain things that haven't triggered, but I'm not going to stay within just, that is my only source of nutrients, reintroducing, one thing at a time from there has been my sort of protocol.
A good starting point, it depends how bad you are, but a good starting point, and this is from Dr. Ruscio, is paleo. He says when people kind of want to generally figure out like what's going on and, they're in the beginning stages, he said paleo is a good place to start because paleo eliminates a lot of the common food intolerances that people have. The problem is when I talk to people about eating paleo or eating keto or whatever, is especially from a food intolerance perspective, they don't realize just how easy it is to get things that, like for example, gluten. Like, did you know that certain marinades and sauces and things have, like soy sauce.
I know.
Soy sauce is full of gluten. A lot of people don't know that. So if you're doing paleo and you're adding soy sauce to something, because some people do paleo and they're not super strict, right? They're just doing it for performance and whatever. But some people do paleo because they have autoimmune issues and they need to be strict. But then they try paleo and they're like, it didn't work for me. Well, the problem was that a lot of the things that you use, you don't realize that there's common, there's food intolerance foods in there. And the cool thing about Thrive is that they do that for you, they categorize it. So you could literally go to Thrive Market, click on paleo, and it's very strict.
So much easier.
Yeah, it's very strict. So the sauce is on there, the product, everything on there kind of meets that. And I do believe they have a gluten-free option too, which if you're gluten-free, you're not just avoiding, gluten for the most part. If you're really gluten-free, you can't even have a trace of it, or at least you don't want a trace of it. And they've also categorized that. So what do I think of the autoimmune protocol for someone with Hashimoto's? I think you should try it. But if you do try it, be vigilant.
Yes.
You're not just dealing
with... And you're not going to feel it overnight. It's something that you have to...
No, and you're not just dealing with, I'm doing this diet because I want to lose weight and I want to get in better shape. You're dealing with an actual autoimmune issue, in which case even the smallest amount is going to prevent you from seeing the potential benefits. So if you do the autoimmune protocol, be strict as hell on it. Like literally, don't even let your food touch other foods that have potential intolerances to you. Be very strict. Do that for at least 3 months and then see if you notice any effects. But I personally know people who have had dramatic effects from changing their diet for autoimmune issues. I had a client who had rheumatoid arthritis who almost completely, nothing. Like, and again, I've talked to about my godson before about the carbohydrate-specific diet with Crohn's. Like, almost total remission. Like, that's fucking crazy. You know what I mean? So there you go.
Next question is from Camilla Montanher. What is the best program for fat loss?
Oh, I know why you picked this one.
Yeah. That's a tough... You know what?
Common question.
Yeah, super common, right? If you're... I want to make sure I answer this as accurately as possible, because off the top of my head, generally speaking, that's an easy one. I can say MAPS HIT, generally, and I'll explain that in a second. But generally, MAPS HIT, by far, in a six-week period, will burn more body fat on the average healthy person than any other program that you'll find. Now, when I say generally, the reason why I say generally is because if you're in a state of metabolic damage, if you've already come out of a HIIT style program, if you diet super extreme, let's say you just competed in a bikini competition or you just ran a long ass 1200 calorie diet, then MAPS HIIT will not be the best program for you. That'll just cause more metabolic adaptation,
right,
and will be the opposite. In that case, I would go MAPS anabolic or something like that, where you're building the metabolism, but building the strength. But as far as just pure fat loss in a short period of time, MAPS HIIT, hands down, by far.
No, MAPS HIIT, I agree with you, but I think it's so true that if you're somebody who takes those Orange Theory classes, or you're into CrossFit, or you're into this type of explosive plyometric type of work or training, and then you purchase our MAPS HIIT and you're expecting it to be the fastest fat loss, I don't think you're going to see that. But if that same person that's into of all that type of training, and that's what they gravitate towards most of the time, if they were to do MAPS RED, that would actually be the greatest program for fat loss.
It's so funny. We release MAPS HIIT, right? And we put on there a warning and we tell people, like, yes, it is the most effective fat loss program we have in that, you know, 6 week period of time. However, you know, if you have metabolic damage, don't do it. If you overtrain, don't do this and that, right? We're trying to maintain as much integrity as possible. And then I look in the forum and the people who are raving, oh my God, I love this pro, whatever. And I know these people because they've been in our forum for a long time. Some of them should not be fucking doing HIIT. And I am going to call you out, not on the podcast, but I am going to message you, because I know some of you, because I've talked to some of you, you know, on the side, and you would ask questions like, why can't I lose weight? I'm only eating 1200 calories. And when I'm like, okay, your metabolism has been fucking adapted, right, because you've done this for so long. You should not be doing HIIT.
This is one of those things where we try to deliver the most education, the most direct kind of like, look, start here. Like, this is really what you need to do specifically. And we try and highlight all those type of avatars. Like, if you're this person, this will work best for you. If you're this person, this will work best for you. But this is where we start to flirt in to what people, like, they really want. They want like a high intensity style workout, because it kind of feeds, you know, this type of mechanism. They're like, they love that. They crave it. They know that, you know, if it's something that you have been doing, that it definitely does promote, you know, fat loss. It promotes, you know, a lot of burning calories. I mean, there's no denying that. It's just that, you know, as trainers, we have this sort of integrity based approach to it, where we really try to guide, you know, teach a man to fish, you know, so that way you can make sound decisions on your own. But yes, that is an option. So, you know, it's there. It's there once you put the foundational work there.
Oh, it's alluring. It's alluring because it's burned body fat.
It's going right to the top.
Yeah, I mean, I tell you what, if you're in the right state, so if your body's not in this metabolic damage or whatever, and you do a six-week MAPS HIIT program with good nutrition, 3-6% body fat loss in a six-week period, you could do that. You'd have to have good diet too, by the way. A program's not going to burn body fat on you if you have a shitty diet, but... you know, 3-6% loss in body fat can definitely happen, and that's dramatic. Like, if you're a 15% body fat guy, which 15% is kind of average body fat, you're not overweight, but you're not lean, super lean, you're just kind of like your average dude, maybe the dad bod, right? That'd probably be around 15-17%. You drop 6% body fat, you might have a six-pack. Yeah. That's a pretty dramatic change in a short period of time. So, yeah, definitely, by far, generally, MAPS HIIT will burn the most body fat. However, if this is what you've been doing, if you've been dieting super hard for a long time already, not the program for you, in which case we recommend something like MAPS.
Yeah, in a perfect world, I think you have one or two of our programs, and MAPS HIIT is what bridges you between programs, or finishes off a program, right?
I'm going to be doing that. So I'm going to be doing that pretty soon. I'm going to phase my way out of our more traditional programs. I'm going to do HIIT for just a few weeks, but it's not for fat loss. I'm doing it because I want the conditioning because I haven't trained like that in so long.
Right.
And I feel like my stamina is just...
That would be great.
Yeah. I feel like it's terrible. Like we were running in the airport and I was like, okay, it's time for me to start improving my stamina.
Next question is from Mike Peterson. How important is the mind-muscle connection?
Super important. You know, it's funny. One of the things I love most about what we do is we have the opportunity to talk with really, really smart people. And I would never have the leverage or opportunity to talk to them if I didn't have a podcast. And recently, we got to sit down with Ben Pakulski.
I knew you were going to go this way.
And Ben Pakulski is
Mr. Mind Muscle Connection.
He is. And he's a very, very intelligent person, and which makes him a genius in the bodybuilding world because a lot of the guys in the bodybuilding world aren't very smart, unfortunately. But Ben is just he's a very, very intelligent individual, very objective. And we had some great conversation. And he said something to me that I had to stop and think about and examine in my own personal experience because he made a claim. And his claim was there was two parts. He said, number one, nobody has weak muscles. In other words, nobody has a weak body part. So if you can build muscle in your body, then all of your muscles can build. And the reason why you have a weak body part is besides muscle insertions and stuff like that is because you have a poor
connection.
You have comparatively, right? A poor connection. So he said that and I thought about it. I'm like, is that true? And I started thinking about it. And the other thing he said that was kind of crazy was if somebody has a weak body part, he said 100% of the time that body part will have a very tough time connecting or at least be weak in its most shortened position. So let me explain what I mean. Let's say my biceps just don't respond like the rest of my body. When I go to test the strength of my bicep in its most shortened position, that's where I'm totally, totally flexed, then I'm probably going to be weak or weakest in that position comparatively. So I thought about that, and I thought really hard about all the clients I've trained. I thought about myself and my weak body parts, and I think there's definitely some validity. I don't know if I could say 100% of the time. That's probably based on his experience. But I'm thinking about the times I've trained women with glutes that didn't want to develop or when my lats didn't want to develop when I was younger or, you know, my chest or other clients when they had a weak body part. And I think he might be right. I think he's right. It's in that super shortened position where they tend to be the weakest. And if you think about it, when you shorten a muscle as shortened as you can, then you try to squeeze into it and connect, that requires a lot of mind-muscle connection, yeah, right?
A lot more focus.
Yeah.
It's the same concept within the FRC system, and that's really what a lot of it amounts to, that connectivity you can get neurologically. So you can direct, attention to joints, specific joints. And so their whole approach is to really identify each individual joint first and get connectivity. And so it's basically kind of like the bodybuilder mentality. They both reflect each other a lot where they're isolating. They're isolating joints. How do I isolate it while, tensing and anchoring and shutting off abilities of the rest of my body so I don't get my shoulder to rotate with it. I don't get my hips rotating with it. It's everything stabilized while now I freed up my joint to perform, different rotations, different functions it's supposed to. So similar to that, now if I slow things down and I'm trying to actually increase strength, like in the shortened position, like you'd mentioned, in like a bicep curl or something like that, and I really connect and squeeze to that, and now I incrementally make my way through the full range, but I'm connected to that whole process. I mean, that's a whole new landscape of strength.
This is why tension is so effective. When they do studies on applying isometric tension to regular routines, there's a profound benefit in strength and muscle. And I think it's because when you're doing isometric, you're connecting to it rather than moving a weight where
you can use momentum.
Momentum, yeah. And other muscles can help.
Yeah, yeah.
And,
yeah, absolutely. Lots of contributors,
you know?
Yeah.
And the best, I mean, I tell you, say what you will about bodybuilders and their training or whatever. Easily, I can make this claim all day long. The athletes that have the best control over individual muscles, bodybuilders.
Oh, 100%.
By far. Yeah.
100%.
They're very focused.
I can take the same exercise, like let's say a lat pull down, and I can make that work so many different muscles for sure. just by mentally connecting as you pull down. Now, sure, in general, your lats and certain muscles are going to be engaged, but you can definitely put more emphasis on different parts of your body that perform a similar movement just by mentally focusing on it. And I think that's something that, you know, bodybuilders are trained to do because we're trying to we're trying to isolate these parts and develop these parts of our body that don't look to proportion to something else, where the average person is that's just trying to be healthy or in shape, or an athlete that's trying to perform, they're just trying to move and they want their body to move together.
Yeah.
Well, you know, a bodybuilder is a sculptor. You know, I don't care about moving the weight or the most weight possible. I care about specific muscles that I'm trying to address are getting most of the load. And there takes I love training this way. This is how I trained all through my competing, and this is how I want to get back into training.
It's the difference between, it's like chess. Yep. You know what I mean? It's like chess. It's the chess of working out in the sense that you have to be really concentrated and intricate with feeling particular, rather than perfecting a movement where, I mean, athletes want to perfect movement.
I think it shapes our body.
It should be a precursor. So like I look at it as like being able to connect on a high level. But, you know, it's really challenging to get from that focus now getting into the gross motor movements and perfecting the mechanics with shutting certain mechanisms off. So, like, you want to, like, for instance, if you're deadlifting, but your natural tendency is to now I want to pull it, you know, with my arms and get my biceps and everything involved, where now I have to, like, use this as an overall gross motor movement. And it's tough. It's a tough transition.
Well, I can tell by looking at somebody's body in the gym, I believe how good of a mind muscle connection they have.
Oh, bro.
I literally feel like I can walk in a gym and I could see. And
bro, we have an example in this room.
Right.
Like the difference between when, remember that day? Okay, we all worked out with Ben Pack, not this last time, but the time before. And and Ben was, walking over to Justin a lot and doing stuff with him with his workouts. Now, this has nothing to do with the fact that Justin knows how to work out. He's a fucking excellent trainer. But Justin's an athlete first and a bodybuilder fourth. Like if you go down the list of things that he is, he's an athlete number one, and he only trained like a bodybuilder probably for a short period of time. Mm-hmm. So the way you train and move the weights was very different than the way me and Adam move the weights when we're training like bodybuilders.
Right.
Because it's something we've practiced for a long
time.
There's
a start, there's a destination, whereas, you know, the way that he was trained, like say it's the rear delts. Like that was the one that was the most awkward for me because like I haven't educated my body as far as like the mechanics involved with trying to isolate, you know, the rear delt specifically, you know, from that position. And so it was like a foreign animal to me. So it's definitely like training. You're patterning the whole time. You're patterning the sequence, and it's something that, you know, becomes a default. And so, for me, that was like an alien concept that just shows me that I could spend some time with that and get some benefit to it.
Well, it all just depends on what you want, right?
Like
if you don't tend to care that much about looking a certain way, so who gives a fuck? You know what I'm saying? Because if you care more about moving and your body working synergistically together, and you do that very, very well. What I think I do really, really well is I can grab any piece of machine or dumbbell or weight and I could fire whatever muscle I want. And I've now seen the effects of that. It's created a more shapely physique. I mean, I've been able to shape. I mean, I remember being told that I had horrible shoulders and no rear delts. And that's a strength of mine now. That's a strength of mine because I've gone to the drawing board.
But do you remember the process of learning how to connect to them and feel them?
Yeah. You know, I mean, up until that point, I did shoulder exercises. I did the ones that you always see in the magazines, or I do what I saw that were there. Like I wasn't performing movements with an intent like I later on learned to do. And I saw a huge difference in the way my body. Now, put me against someone like Justin, who's been training more like an athlete, and if we had to, you know, do a bench press competition, I would say he would outperform me in a lot of movements like that because he will get that weight up, and he's taught his entire body all the way from his toes to his head to engage to get that weight off of his chest, where I don't train that way. I control it with a 4-second negative and pause and then come out.
You're also trying to feel the pecs.
Right, exactly. I don't want to feel it in my legs. I don't want to feel it in my core. I don't want to feel it anywhere else but my chest, and so I won't be able to probably move as much weight, but I've learned to control it that way and keep it in an area that I'm trying to develop, and it's changed.
When it comes to sculpting your body, okay, movement makes a big difference, especially initially learning how to bench and squat and deadlift and do the good form. But after a while, like, if you want to sculpt your body, the mind to muscle connection is everything. I mean, it really is. It's almost everything. Like, I can almost, how many times have we had clients that have come to us and said, oh, I can't build my butt. And I don't go have them do a bunch of great butt building exercises. First, I get them to connect to their butt. And then we do the butt building. Yeah. It's like, that's what, look, we did a mod, right? What is it?
Step A.
The butt builder bundle that we have. Where we combine MAPS Anabolic and MAPS Aesthetic, I believe.
Yep.
And we put a mod in there that's specifically designed to give you the mind-muscle connection, because there's a lot of different ways your body can squat. And if you're trying to develop your glutes, then you want to have a good connection with your glutes so that when you do the squat, the glutes are firing the way you want, and now they develop and you sculpt the body. I did want to say something real quick. The FRC, you guys were comparing it in a previous episode to, what was it,
PNF.
PNF. Here's one of the big differences. FRC, when you're in a position, you have a progressive tension, so you're flexing the muscles that you're actually stretching, but you also do regressive, where you flex the muscles that are shortened.
Mm-hmm.
PNF doesn't do that.
Oh, okay.
PNF is all progressive. So that was one of the big differences. I want to say that because I got a message from somebody who's like, no, and they listed other differences too, but that was the bigger one.
Yeah, no, it by no means is it the same thing.
It's just comparable. We weren't saying it's the same thing.
They've built on that science. They've built on that information.
The pails and rails is definitely like it's a reflection of
I'm a huge fan of Ken Stretch, and I use that only. I don't even use PNF because I think of it as a superior way of utilizing some science, and we've built off of that.
And even with PNF, I used to use I would use somebody else like to help me stretch my way through that, right?
Well, that's what PNF is. You have to use somebody else,
which is, you know, FRC, you do it yourself.
And that is the big difference is you're not getting an outside force. You're having to connect to that, like you're saying right now. That's a major difference.
Make sure you go to the App Store and download our app to listen to our podcast. You can actually search different topics and stuff in the app, pull up the shows
Better than Angry Birds.
It's free. It's also free, so go do it.
I always get excited when Ben comes into the studio. It's always nice to get caught up with him. He's a good friend of all of ours and
a great podcast.
And I'll be honest, like I don't have enough time to listen to my own podcast. So a lot of times I don't get a chance to listen to all his episodes. So one of my favorite things just to ask him is like, dude, who have you interviewed recently that has like blown your mind? And he normally gives me a couple episodes that is just phenomenal to listen to. And he interviewed the guy, and the funny part about this is we've actually performed some of these exercises. Right. We've taught some of these guys.
We've used his techniques in our programs, which is great.
And the McGill Airplane, right? Isn't that what it's called?
Yes, yeah. And Ben had the privilege to interview him. What was the name of the episode, Sal?
The episode was How to Get Extreme Okinawan Strength, 3 Ways to Fix Low Back Pain, and the Best Core Exercises. And it was with Stu McGill, who's like this brilliant, brilliant individual that understands how to work and correct back pain. In the episode, he talks about how to clinically study like the best back pain exercises with EMG, so you can see how muscles are firing using that technique. He talks about which exercises have been shown to actually reduce back pain because they're not all the same. Didn't he write a book? Was it The Gift of Injury?
Yeah, The Gift of Injury.
And that was about how he rehabbed a powerlifter who took basically the guy was like not going to be able to move anymore.
Anyways, is a great episode to make sure for you guys to tune into. So make sure, I know a lot of people that listen to our show also listen to Ben. It's tough to consume all of the content. Mm-hmm. So I always like to get caught up with him and find out.
We may have to steal him as a guest next.
I think that's a great, especially since we're stealing his exercises. So
at least we can do is get him on our show.
Absolutely. So the podcast, Ben Greedfield Fitness, go check that episode out.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.